Thanks so much for joining us.
Hi, Laura.
Great to see you.
Hello, everyone.
I think we still have
This is a decent room,
I know,
actually.
It's great, isn't it? Did you notice it's bathed in Street Fight Green? Big fan of that. When you guys have your Foursquare event here, you can do it in blue and pink.
Watermelon. It's watermelon.
Watermelon.
It's not pink.
Okay.
It's watermelon.
Okay. So I just wanted to start off with Foursquare has gone through, has evolved a lot over the years. It's no longer 2012 and 2013 or even 2009 with check-ins and people competing for badges. So can you just give us a snapshot of what the focus is now for some of those still getting up to speed?
Sure. Well, I joined the company 3 years ago this week, and so it's a very different company than a lot of folks might know from 2012 or 13. So we still have check-ins, although, and we still have about 50 million people around the world who come use our apps and website each month in over 170 countries. And we actually do more check-ins a day, 7 million check-ins a day, than we did 2 years ago. So the engagement and check-ins per user are significantly up. That said, over 90% of the business for Foursquare now is as a location intelligence company. And what that means is over 90% of our business, which is growing like crazy, is as an enterprise and B2B company and media company. So there's sort of three broad things that we're up to on that side beyond the consumer apps. So first is we are a developer platform. And so there are 100,000 apps using our APIs, now our SDK, to build what we call contextual computing. So, we are Uber's directory for their drivers of places to pick up or drop off. We host Twitter's tagging. We host Pinterest tagging. We're baked into the Samsung phones, Bixby and AI. We tag every photo on a Galaxy device so you can create albums. We are part of Apple Maps. We're part of Bing. We're part of Cortana. We're the recommendation engine around the world on Windows 10. So we're doing a ton of things with 100,000 developers. We just announced Reddit tagging using our APIs and the like. So 100,000 companies using the developer platform, and that's about 40% of the business. And then we measurement and analytics. So we've predicted, as we might talk about, what's going on. 90% of spending still happens in the real world. So we've famously predicted Chipotle sales would be down 30% 2 weeks before their earnings call accurately, and lots of other calls. And so we do that. We can measure whether ads drive people into chains. We do that for scores of leading, brick and mortar brands. Right. See whether an ad led people into their stores. We should talk a little bit about that. Yep. And then, of course, media, our pinpoint business. We have 50 of the 100 largest brands in the world using us to help identify audiences, because the places people go is the best indicator of who they are. And so we can talk about that. So those are all businesses growing, near 100% year over year. The business is growing like crazy, and it's been a lot of fun. So it's very, but it's, not over 90% of the business as a business didn't exist 3 years ago.
In terms of running it or the operations or kind of all of the above.
Well, I just mean that those product lines that are the B2B product lines didn't exist 3 years ago, and now they are the vast majority of the company, and they're growing like crazy.
Right. And the consumer side, are you going to, you're going to maintain that?
But yeah, absolutely.
Not like a specific growth area.
With 50 million users, we are big enough to map the world, just a few that, and so that is, that doesn't have to grow for us to succeed. We are able very accurately, all these companies using us as the most accurate place database in the world. And it's not just like, what's the phone number of a plumber in Mexico City? It's really this fingerprinting technology that we call Pilgrim that through over 11 billion, almost 12 billion check-ins, we now have collected the sensor data inside 100 million businesses in the world, which means your phone can be in your purse or in your pocket or your bag, and we detect when phones move in and out of 100 million businesses in 170 plus countries. And so that is really the core of almost everything we do, is that passive awareness, and that relies on that healthy consumer mapping. Although now with the SDK, we can get into it, but we see a much, you know, order of magnitude bigger audience through partners using the developer tools than we do in our own sort of 50 million users.
Right. How do you sort of check those against each other? The sensor data, which I assume is sort of the passive location services data you're collecting, versus the check-ins. Like, does one sort of verify the other?
Yeah, so basically it's a machine learning problem. And so it turns out if you want to predict whether a phone in your pocket walks into 100 million different places, you need ground truth and real ground truth, which is the places people are going and confirmation of that and billions of times. And then we have a huge team of data scientists. But, you know, we know the Wi-Fi 14 strong SSIDs on the 10th floor of a building and how different they are than the nightclub in the basement or the bakery on the first floor.
Yeah.
And you can only collect that truth in dense urban areas if you have billions of times people saying, no, I'm at the cupcake bakery and not at the yoga studio next door, so we can get that fingerprinting. So you need billions of data points to do this accurately. Otherwise, like, there's a lot of companies in this space who are doing, you know, kind of very bad geofencing or very bad satellite map stuff. They can't distinguish dense businesses within a mall or a crowded urban street like we can. They can't tell vertical businesses one apart. And I always ask, like, what's your ground truth set? How do you know if you're accurate? We have 12 billion times people have told us the answer that we can check our determinations against. There's no one else in the space who has that.
Yeah. Right. Okay, that's interesting. I mean, you said you have 100 million places, too. I feel like that's not a data point you just mentioned.
Yeah, there's 93 million public places, and then there's well over 100 million places that we map, but some of them are homes or private spaces.
So I want to talk about some of the uses for your data, like some of the analytics part of it. You know, most people in the room are focused more on the advertiser marketer side, but... So we should definitely talk about that, and I like the TGI Fridays, and I think there was another case study you were just talking about backstage. But like, also talk about, you know, hedge funds and other kind of, you know, outside the marketer uses.
Well, you know, there's lots of different approaches, and it's a big ecosystem. So our approach has been, we want to be deep strategic partners with really leading global brands. Mm-hmm. So we don't even sell to SMBs, for instance.
Yeah.
We rely on partners like Brandify and others to aggregate those listings and bring them into our system. So the key is, you know, we work with, I'll give you an example, like we work with TGI Fridays and how all the pieces fit together for one of our strategic partners. We work with TGI Fridays. They were one of the first customers for Foursquare Analytics, which is kind of like a Nielsen or Google Analytics of the real world. You can see in aggregate anonymously how you're doing at foot traffic and across thousands of locations versus competitors. But you can look at it granularly by demographics, by time of day, you know, by where people go before and after. And one of the things that showed up in the analytics was that they really did well from people coming straight from movie theaters to TGIF, and particularly on certain nights of the week. So from that insight, we helped them then go over from Foursquare Analytics to pinpoint and be able to really target people who were at movie theaters and bring them directly in on certain days. So that's, you know, an example of how you can use our analytics media and then our measurement to see whether the ads are working. So this campaign that was movie specific, you know, was working better than a different generic, let's say, sale coupon campaign. And you could see that in the data with our attribution product. So we kind of want to work to be a thought partner for these leading folks. And then where people go, you know, Panera, I think, was an example we talked about, which is where, so Panera, you know, there's a dirty secret about salads, people, which is that, you know, sometimes salads have more calories than the Big Mac, right? Does anyone know that? So, you know, you get the double bacon, blue cheese salad. It's like, it's worse than a Big Mac on the saturated fat. Anyway, so Panera really wanted to introduce a truly healthy line of new signature food. And they came to us and said, how could we really find the people who are sophisticated and would want this? So we built them a really cool audience of people who go to yoga studios and CrossFit and shop at organic groceries and Whole Foods and a host of other affiliations. And the campaign did really well to help launch these new products. So it's really like the places you go say so much about who you are. So those are ways that different pieces fit together. And obviously some folks using our developer tools as well.
Right. Well, actually on that TGI Fridays moviegoer attribution thing, could you just kind of walk us through exactly that, how that happens from, you know, identifying them through the attribution part and knowing that the advertising worked? How do you do that?
How the attribution works.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting thing because there's a lot of nonsense going on in the industry. So one of the things we're really proud of is, I'm a former marketer, if you ever saw the Travelocity roaming gnome, I'm responsible for him, you can blame me.
That was you.
I spent $100 million a year on a concrete lawn ornament kidnapped and going around the world. But I really believe in the science of incrementality in marketing, right? And so the question is, what is the incremental lift? And so how we build our attribution product is really to help marketers understand what is the incremental piece of business that a given ad exposure drives. So we filed, you know, patent around this, the ability to sort of like, so let's say you expose 2 million people to a retargeting campaign. Maybe they're former Chipotle goers, or maybe they're heavy loyalists of Starbucks or whatever, and you run this campaign, we will find a matching several million people who have the same demographics and the same history of going to Chipotle or Starbucks or whatever. So it's really apples to apples. Mm-hmm. If you're targeting frequent customers and your comparison set is the frequency of going compared to the general public, every ad campaign, even if you didn't actually run the ads, is going to show lift because you're comparing loyalists for a brand to the general population, right? And so we really have filed this patent around understanding deeply apples to apples lift. And so what we do is, you know, on when was the device exposed to the ad digitally, whether desktop or mobile, and then we'll watch over the next 30 days the people who are exposed to the ad versus a matching control group, and we'll see through our passive technology.
And you can see what they ordered.
We don't see whether they order, they see whether they walk in, but for these, you know, we work with 9 of the 10 QSRs. Yeah. You walk into a McDonald's or you walk into a Subway, you know, it's not like a website. You're going to buy a sandwich.
Yeah.
And they know what a customer is worth. So that's true lift. And there's, you know, there is a competitor out there that has been throwing out some really unsophisticated scams, I think, on this, so I want to call it out, because why not? It's fun. I want to particularly cite, in a laudatory way, Duncan from PlaceIQ, who's down there looking at his phone, because he wrote a great...
He's tweeting what you're saying.
You're tweeting how brilliant I am, right? Duncan wrote a great piece today in one of the ad trades about, you know, the idea, there's this, like, slippery idea that one company has brought up, like, hey, just pay us if I drive people into your store. I will measure whether I drove someone in your store. And just pay me each time I bring you a customer. Sounds great, right? Just pay me $6 every time someone walks in the door. Well, the problem is, if you don't have a control group, you're doing, like, cookie bombing. So basically now, I'm going to get you to pay me for everyone who would have walked into your store anyways. At $6 a pop, and it's performance oriented. You only pay me if I deliver. But I basically,
if I just show an ad, I get
to claim credit for them.
Are you saying that at the end of the day, the marketer is spending the same amount? They're just feeling better because it's
No, the marketer is going to get bilked because let's say you drive 150,000 incremental visits from a $100,000 campaign. Well, now you're going to pay $600,000 because you're paying $6 a visit, but only 20% of them were incremental. The other 80% would have come anyways, particularly if you're marketing to your own loyalists.
Right.
And we can see this through control group A-B testing.
Yeah.
So you should only pay for marketing, any kind of marketing, whether it's TV or digital or anything. You should only pay for lift, and you should be scientific about it. And you can either do multi-touch attribution and complex models, or you can do a very straightforward A-B test, which where, you know, one group is similar to the other and you hold the equal, you can see very powerfully and very statistically, you know, whether the ads are working for this demographic or that and what the lift is. And, you know, we did that digitally. We did that at Travelocity, where I spent $1 billion on marketers we A/B test retargeting. This is retargeting in the real world, folks. So go forth and have, you know, read Duncan's op-ed. But really, the key is pretty simple. Marketers should pay for lift. You should measure the lift. And that's what our attribution product lets you see, is the incremental lift, what you really get for the incremental dollar.
Yeah. So you guys obviously really believe in your location data, of course. So, you know, it's a big problem in the industry, across the industry, location data. What's smoke and mirrors, and what's real, and what's, you know, how do we solve this problem?
Yeah, you know, for us, I mean, we're a technology company, so I mean, you know, we've spent hundreds of millions of dollars really working on the technology. We're an engineering company, and so it's just kind of not our way to approach it in any way, but a really sort of scientific integrity based way.
Yeah, there but is. Everyone would say that.
Yeah,
you know? I mean,
well,
they're not going to say we keep integrity on the shelf.
Yeah, but you know, this is ad. A lot, you know, a lot of what we do is not ad tech. And I don't think we're an ad tech company, but it's not a secret that there's a lot of smoke and mirrors on the ad tech side. And so, I mean, I'm gonna continue to call it out and hope people are smart, because there are ways to tell. I mean, you know, a couple of the scams going on. First of all, for years, we were calling out that people were buying location data on these programmatic exchanges, where you'd get an ad call, and it turns out we knew, because we have millions of users who confirm their location, and our millions of our own users, we knew that 80% of the locations being sold on a MoPub or other exchanges are just flat out lies. They're miles from the users. So there's that problem. Now the industry is like, oh yeah, you know, we knew that was bad, but there are companies.
Yeah,
here
I
that
feel
were
like
built
we reached
that.
This point where there's sort of just an acceptance that it's, you know, it's all but fuzzy.
Well, there's flat out lies, right? It's not fake news. They're just like, these people are 10 miles from where you say they are. And so, because a lot of apps would feed false data in to try to get location-based ads from the exchanges. So that's one lie. The second thing is, now you're seeing this whole industry prop up that is taking these very inaccurate log file readings and buying them from a flashlight app or a game. Mm-hmm. So you might, you know, there are companies like SafeGraph that will go to games and they'll say, well, once an hour, take a location for me, and I'm gonna market it to the entire ad tech industry and log file. Well, the thing is, again, it's just like programmatic nonsense, right? You could be driving by the J. Crew, and your location gets captured and into a really bad geofence, right? A really bad geofence. Now you're a J. Crew visitor. You were fucking driving by. Like, you know, it's nonsense. And so it's a lot of baloney. And so it's why, you know, whether it's the Foursquare users or all the users of the Capital One mobile wallet or all the users of TouchTune or thousands of other apps using our stuff, we have a consistent technology in each case that's on the device, that's listening to the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth signals, looking at the accelerometer, knows that you actually stopped and walked around in that J. Crew. And so we're trying to build a gold standard of truth for the industry. And we're passionate about it. And, you know, I hope we win.
So as you build that, you know, one of the things I have to ask you about, and then I hope we can have time for a question or two. But Foursquare was famously in the past talking to Google and other people about an exit. What's the plan there?
Well, that was a while back. So I mean, I think
I know.
I think
now.
Well, certainly not while I've been there. I mean, look, we're the business. We grew 74% last year. We're eyeing our first profitable quarter. We're thinking big. I mean, this is a company that if it keeps growing, we could be an IPO kind of company in a couple years so or less. So, I mean, I'm excited about where we're going. I mean, obviously there are strategic players in the industry that are much bigger. But if you think about where we've had success at a big picture, you know, it's our customers are all people who don't want to rely on Google and Facebook. Mm-hmm. There's really only three companies that have the global scale of ground truth and accuracy that we do, and that's Facebook, Google, and Foursquare. And so you look at our customers like, you know, Uber and Apple and Microsoft and Tencent and Samsung and all these folks, what do they have in common? And big advertisers who don't want to be overly dependent on the big two gorillas. Like, everyone wants a viable alternative in Switzerland. Yeah. So that's, I think that's a great space, because there's a lot of people who fear Google and Facebook.
So no looking for buyers.
That's not what we're up to.
Okay. What about buying? What about acquisitions?
You know, we're not looking at anything right now. I mean, as we grow, sure, we might acquire smaller companies.
Yeah.
You know, sure.
Okay. We've got actually only 30 seconds. Does anyone have a question? Got one in the back. If you could use the mic.
Thank you. Thanks, Jeff. I was just curious, as an app developer, in the year 2017, how you look at iOS versus Android, pros, cons, just how you perceive them and how you leverage them in the data you're grabbing.
Great question.
Yeah. Well, obviously, we're spending a lot of time thinking about this as we study iOS 11 and we study Google O, Android O. Where they're making some changes to the way location background awareness is shared. So I think in maybe the next 90 days, I'll have a more considered view on where the platforms are going. They're obviously changing background access. You see this new blue bar that's appearing in iOS 11 for accessing background location, but it only applies in certain cases. So we're studying it. I think, you know, in general, historically, Google has been better than Apple because Google has allowed developers like us to look at the Wi-Fi fingerprints, which we use extensively. It's almost 90% as accurate as GPS in our testing, whereas Apple sort of contains that. So Google has been better, but we'll see. So I think it's evolving is a short answer. Happy to talk to you more afterwards.
Okay, thanks. And yeah, Jeff, you're gonna be around in case people have more questions. Thank you so much.
Thanks,
really appreciate
Laura.
Your time.
Yeah. Thanks for the invitation. Thanks, all.